He later became, in 1980, the chief of the Paris Police Department, and he resigned that position in 1990 when he was elected sheriff of Oxford County. Here tonight to talk about the history of the Oxford County Jail, the man who probably knows more about it than anyone else right now anyway, Sheriff Herrick.
Until that time, I had never previewed took the prisoner in. I can't recall what he was arrested for or brought in for, what I brought him in for. But the jailer at that time said, well, you want to help me process him and do the paperwork, which was important for me to know, to learn how to do as a new law enforcement officer. Taking, and then after the paperwork's done, taking him into the cell area, as a description portrays, it was just something that was all steel bars, steel floor, just everything. There wasn't for lights. There wouldn't be any direct light into the area. And I all of a sudden I started really feeling sorry for the guy, and I can't recall what I arrested him for, but I felt sorry. I said, boy, this is really jail, no doubt about it. These cells were made of metal with steel bars. Very small, though they held two prisoners. These cells had water and toilets, were back to back each other, with those on the other side. The inmates could not visit with the inmates on the other side, and they had only a small corridor in front of their cells to walk back and forth for exercise. The outer cage was of heavy steel bars, and this provided double locking of prisoners. And I do recall, and even today, the old jail exists. We use it for storage facility. But again, it is double barred. The outer cage was of heavy steel bars, and this provided double locking of prisoners in the individual cells in the outer cage. Besides this, the windows all had steel bars, and in the doors in the out of the, excuse me, and the door in and out of the block consisted of steel bars also. The inner door was made out of solid steel. It was just, you looked at it, and that it was a solid steel door. There's nothing you can say more about it. The downstairs block was similar. This is the first tier block, first level, ground level block that housed the less serious prisoners. The downstairs block was similar, except the cells within the cage faced each other and provided more space for the inmates to gather. When not locked in the individual cells, and not a pleasant place to be, hot, cramped, and smelly, this old jail would not meet today's standards. The sheriff was provided with a spacious apartment, but it was part of his office area and served others besides himself and family. The wife of the sheriff was expected to prepare the meals and serve the jail inmates, and also, when Superior Court was setting, provided lodging and meals to the presiding justices. If he chose to stay as a guest of the sheriff, which he did at times, chose to stay with the sheriff. Some sheriffs and or their wives preferred not to stay in the apartment, and the apartment was then occupied by a jailer and his wife with the same duties as was required by the sheriff. Whoever occupied this had the responsibility of guarding and checking on the inmates during the night. The jailer would retire to the apartment in the late evening, and if the local police or a deputy brought a prisoner in to the jail at night, they would ring the bell, and the sheriff or jailer would get up and take charge of that prisoner, that person being committed to jail. In later years, a deputy worked the night duty from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m., and he stayed in the sheriff's office, which was part of the facility, and answered the telephone. The telephone was the only means of communications for many years. He also had the responsibility of calling and dispatching a deputy when needed, booking prisoners that were brought in and checking on the inmate population. He had a cot in the office that he could sleep on until called by a phone or a bell. And, you know, as I read this, I can remember when that was taking place too. The sheriff's duties were many, and he had a few deputies to help on a full-time basis. He had to rely on his per diem deputies to serve when called. Per diem deputies were appointed throughout the county to serve the towns within their assigned areas. There was no formal training for these officers. They learned on the job and with instructions provided by the sheriff or one of his full-time deputies. responsible for the enforcement of the laws, and this included major and minor crimes, suicide, unattended death, murders, and family fights, and intoxicated persons. He was also responsible for the county jail and its inmates guiding and providing court security for Superior Court and serving of criminal and civil process. The sheriff's full-time staff usually consisted of a chief deputy, a jailer, and if funds were available, a criminal investigator. In spite of these many limitations, the sheriff and his deputies usually gave a very good account of the discharge of their duties. What type of prisoner did the sheriff and his deputies deal with on a day-to-day basis? Though the jail population was low by today's standards, there were probably more in jail for petty offenses than today. Public intoxication provided the bulk of the jail population at any given time. These were not hardened criminals. They were people who didn't bother anyone until they had too much to drink, usually on a Friday or Saturday night, being the end of the work week and most often on payday. Debtors were far more evident in the jail population until the mid-1960s. A person could be committed to jail for a non-payment of debt by a plaintiff's attorney. Committal for debt is very, very rare today, and only after lengthy court proceedings does this take place. What do these people do in jail for work, recreation, and how did society look upon them? Committal to jail under sentence to serve time included loss of rights until released. Prisoners were humanely treated. They were permitted to receive visitors for 1 hour on Sunday. A clergy came to the jail on Sunday afternoon to conduct a service for the inmates and to listen to any matters they might seek advice on. They were fed meals that were adequate, and twice a week, those who smoked were given a pack of Bugler tobacco. And I remember that very well. Them inmates always wanting Bugler and paper, rolling paper. They were taken into the exercise room for an hour when the weather permitted, and the books were donated, distributed. Playing cards were the most popular item for recreation. Those inmates who had been granted trustee status were employed in cleaning the county offices, shoveling snow, raking, and before oil, buck sawing, and splitting wood for the boilers that heated the entire county building complex. These inmates received no pay for their service. It was part of their punishment. The relationship between the inmates and their keeper were usually very good. Respect got respect. And most inmates acknowledged that they were in jail because of their doings, and once they had paid their bill to society, they expected to be restored to their former status in the community. The sheriff and his jailer saw that the jail was kept clean, and at least once a year, a local health officer, usually a physician, inspected the entire facility and made his recommendations. Personal care of themselves by inmates were always enforced. Showers at least, this sounds a little low, but showers at least twice weekly and every Monday. Every Monday morning. Usually it was, unless it was storming, mattresses and blankets were taken into the jail yard and placed on racks for airing in sunshine. Inmates who were ill were treated by a local physician. Prohibition added more people to the sheriff's inmate population, and many, many gallons of illegal liquor in the Depression years also added to more petty crimes. Arrestees and many night lodgers, men without work, who were on the move to any area that might hold the possibility of a job. They were given a night's lodging and breakfast. These were people who were not usually lawbreakers, but people without money. World War II put people back to work. Crime more or less remained of the petty type, intoxication, petty theft, etc. The jail population was below capacity during that time. In the immediate years following the war, more people took to the highways with new cars, trucks, etc. Drinking seemed to increase. Disregard for safety and the rights of ordinary citizens became the new wave. As a result of this activity, residents started demanding more service from their law enforcement agencies, including the sheriff. Since he and his deputies provided the bulk of the service to the rural area, additional funds were budgeted to the sheriff to add more deputies and the equipment necessary for their use. Patrol activities by deputies became more evident in towns without active police officers. It was in 1956 that the Oxford County Sheriff's Department received its first radio. This made it possible for two or three field deputies to respond to complaints more quickly. Communication is all important to law enforcement. Before radios, deputies got their complaint from the sheriff's office in person or by phone. If they left the office to go serve papers or interview a complainant or a suspect, they gave the deputy on duty the times and areas that where they expected to be. If needed, the deputy at the office called the nearest store or person he knew in the area where the deputy he saw was supposed to be. They were asked to look up and down the street to see if they could be seen. If he was, they were asked to tell him to call the office immediately. With the arrival of the decade of 1960s, radical changes occurred in that country. Civil rights activists in all areas of society started beating the drum for more freedom and more rights for various groups in society, which included criminals. These forces were successful in their efforts. Courts granted decisions that gave people more freedom, if it can be called that, and made the law enforcement of the laws more difficult for us, for those of us engaged in that calling. Prisoners in class action suit against jail prisoners, etc., have won decisions that have changed the way these institutions operate today. Decisions affecting the police personnel, laws under which training of personnel, additional staffing, replacement of buildings, providing more in-house rehabilitative services and programs for inmates, etc. The same applies to law enforcement agencies because of so many of these so-called right decisions. The federal government enacted the Law Enforcement Assistance Act. This public law made funding available in the form of grants to provide the training and equipment necessary to upgrade police agencies at all levels. Standards for law enforcement and correctional personnel have been upgraded to the highest level ever. Every person in law enforcement and corrections today must be certified by the Maine Criminal Justice Academy as qualified to perform his or her duty as required by law. These radical decisions impacted on the state agencies too. The Department of Corrections, which oversees the activities of all county jails in the state of Maine, have recognized and extended their authority over these jails. This agency has mandated many changes in county jails, operational policies, which has cost the residents of the county thousands of dollars. In the mid-1970s, the incumbent sheriff, Elton L. Howe, was informed by the Department of Corrections that the Oxford County Jail, the old jail that we're still talking about, did not meet the new standards for such facilities based on the recent court decision. Serious thought should be given to look at building a new jail in Oxford County. The matter was discussed with the county commissioners and other concerned persons. There was at that time a federal agency that had available funding for use in Oxford County to fund two or three municipal projects that would benefit the residents of those towns. Concerned residents of the county at large felt that it would benefit Oxford County if the funds were used to build the needed new jail, and that this was preferred to municipal projects. This prevailed and the grant was approved. The new Oxford County Jail was built in compliance with the new standards, approved and became operational on Saturday, August 11th, 1979. Now that is kind of a back then to now Howe had retired and I took over in 1991, even more things have changed on the horizon of corrections. We used to be able to hold juvenile offenders. We had a separate cell that was away from the adult population, from what they call sight and sound. As recent as a year and a half ago, a decision came down from Washington and it said that we cannot hold juveniles anymore in our facility. We have to find a so-called appropriate facility to house them in during during a certain time period before they go into court. Drastic things have changed on the issues of prisoners' rights. We constantly today deal with the unknown of the HIV disease. We constantly have training, but when I say that the rules have changed for the prisoners, a prisoner can come in and serve time at our facility, and under federal statutes that he is not obligated in any way to tell us that he has the HIV disease. He can also have the hepatitis disease, and we have all been a year ago vaccinated for any contact with anybody with hepatitis. Jail facilities and jail life, as you would call it, has changed dramatically. We have to obtain and are obligated to have a physician that is available almost 24 hours a day. We have to take care of all these people's medication. Our jail staff has to handle that. As I started originally into this information, you can see that usually there was one or two people that oversaw the jail back many years ago. Today, the jail is operated by 12 full-time correctional officers, which include a jail administrator and a assistant administrator, and this man also the assistant administrator oversees any jail program within the facility. And when I say jail program, that is we have still different denominations of clergy come in during the week. We have a adult ed teacher come in, and some people may say, well, geez, why are we doing this? Well, I'd like to think that corrections is a new field to me, but I still feel that if we have an education process that's available, and some of these people, a good majority of these people are very much illiterate when they enter our facility, and if they will take advantage of some of our adult educational process, and they can leave at the end of 30 days or 60 days, or some of them are into the maximum of 9 months, which we can legally hold a person for 9 months, then perhaps they can leave there with a little bit of education. At least maybe they can read a little bit better or write a little bit better. Other programs we have an ongoing AA facilitator, people that come in during the week to talk with the people about alcohol. What you have to remember, even back then, as you heard, and even through today, that the alcohol and of course the drugs that are involved in today's society is probably about 90% of the people that we incarcerate have committed some type of violent crime or property crime due to being under the influence of some type of illegal substance. When I say illegal substance, liquor, of course, is not illegal, only in the hands of minors, but I call it illegal substance when people go out and break the law and they're under the influence, and I call it illegal substance. But we have a lot of programs today that work on a daily basis within our jail facility. Again, back many years ago, they were splitting wood, they were cleaning, they were doing things. Again, with court decisions, the sheriffs back many years ago were able to say to the prisoners, you will go out and chop wood, and you will go out and sweep, and you will go out and clean. Court decisions have changed that dramatically. dramatically. I cannot, as sheriff, go out and go up in the jail and tell any inmate that they have to work. What I had to come up with was some type of plan where I could, I was very strong feeling, and as many sheriffs do today, that in the general public, that it's a waste of time to bring these people into an institution, let them serve time, and just do nothing. What I've done is I've implemented a work program where, again, I can't force them to work, but I can kind of make a deal with them that for every 2 days of labor that they do, I will give them a day off their sentence. And that way it gets them out working, the ones that can qualify depending on their severity of their crime and their classification in the jail. It gets them out to work. And it also takes a day off their sentence for every 2 days of work, which shortens the length of their stay, which produces less meals we have to feed them, and less meals mean less money, and less money is less taxes. And so I'm a true believer that, you know, the ones that do qualify, that we should go out and have them work. And but things have, I mean, I go up and I will recognize grievances that inmates have. Can range anywhere from they're not getting enough to eat, they don't like the food, to they're being mistreated by a corrections officer. Most of the time, they're just looking for attention. They want to talk to the top guy to see if he's any more bendable than the corrections officer. But it, you know, again, the times have changed dramatically. I read the history and can imagine what took place then many, many years ago. I encourage all of you that if you get the opportunity, if you have it, to go up to Paris Hill, look at the old jail. It's a library now, but some of the old round rings that held the prisoners are still into the granite. Some of the stuff is still there and very much exposed, and you can see it. Very interesting to look at it and just close your eyes and think about, you know, prisoners staying in that facility. And you know, it did the job when it was being used. I told Steve that it brought kind of what I consider a very valuable piece of history, and I'd like to pass it around. What this is, it's a gold badge that was presented to this gold badge mined in Swift River, originally presented to Sheriff Hiram R. Hubbard of Paris in 1907. It was requested that it be worn at all high court functions. It has been handed down since that time to each successful holder of the office. And you can read the names, but it's J. Melvin Bartlett, Stoneham, William Frothingham, South Paris, Dale D. Cole, South Paris, Earl C. Torrey, Dixfield, Harry O. Stinson, Norway, Fernando L. Francis, Rumford, Clark C. Hunt, Norway, James Lassiter in Albany, Stephen Conant, Norway, Lester Horton, Albany, Stanley Haskell, Oxford, and Elton Howe wore this August 4th, 1979 at the opening of the new jail facility. So it's a very beautiful, beautiful badge, and it was presented to me when I took over sheriff, but I real quickly found a safe to put it in, because, and I'll pass it around so you folks can look at it. It's really a real beautiful, and it's very unique that the gold came right out of Swift River that it was produced from. Can I answer any questions? Yes, sir.
How many people was the original jail designed to hold?
It's, I'm glad you asked that, because it's a funny, this original jail that we're talking about had 24 beds. And in They were single unit beds. And even back then, the state of Maine said you could keep 24 prisoners, but that's all you can keep. And I remember Elton Howe saying to me, I'd say, how many you got here today, Sheriff? And he said, oh, I got, 24 plus three. And I'd say, well, what do you mean 24 plus three? And he said, well, they tell me I can only keep 24 in the jail, but I've got three out in the hallway. And he said, they're on cots. And he said, the hallway was kind of the booking room area, and it wasn't really the jail. I mean, it was kind of the booking room. So he would get the three most serious offenders, and he would line up three cots, and he'd say, that's your bed for the night. So he felt that he was being covered. The new jail, and this is the ironic part, the new jail that was built in 1979 was built to hold 27 prisoners, three more than the original. And I could never figure out how come, and I can't today. The general contractor of this jail, I found out within the last couple of years, had never built a jail before. And I'm not blaming everything on him, but then again, somebody had to tell him to build a facility for 27 beds, or he just went ahead and did it, I'm not sure. But when I took over sheriff in 1991, Oxford County was faced, why me, I said, but Oxford County was faced with the most overcrowding in its history. There were some days that I had upwards of 62 prisoners. And I read, again, jails are all new to me, I read the state standards that govern county jails, and there was some standards in there that was you could interpret them various ways. I chose to interpret the best way that it was going to be for the taxpayers. And I decided to double bunk. And each cell had one single steel bed hooked to the wall, and I just brought a cot in and just hoped that everybody got along and just double bunked them. And then some of them I had to, some of them I didn't like it, and it was a real serious liability, but if I didn't do something else, I was forced to board these other prisoners out to other counties at roughly $90 a day. And it was going to be too costly, and I said, no, I'm just not going to do it. So what I did was I come up with an idea to take the minimum security, minimum crime people, and I sent them home for 3 days in a row. And what they were home monitored. They were told, they were read the Riot Act, they were told specific rules, you go home, you stay there. We are gonna call 2 times a day, 20 times a day. If you're not there, we're gonna come get you, and we'll lock you up, and you lose all your good time, and we'll add on to your sentence. I was very fortunate. We had about a 60-day period there where we had anywhere from 4 to 15 prisoners out on house arrest, and knock on wood, they were there every time we called them. Matter of fact, we did a couple personal checks at their house. We sent deputies and the cruisers to their house to check on them, and I got by that time. But we now, I've dealt with the Guster and Department of Corrections, and I now can hold, I can double bunk, because they couldn't give me a good reason why I couldn't. I can double bunk 47 inmates now. But we have been relatively low. Today's head count was about 22. And it fluctuates, it depends. And the old theory is, you get more in the wintertime, that's true. Some people just don't have any place to stay. They'll go out and either trespass or pick up Cliff's shop or something at the Shop and Save or whatever, get themselves 30 or 40 days in jail. But it's a whole different ball game compared to what I understand used to be. Yes, yes.
You same.
Do you have authority to put them on road crews picking up litter?
Yeah. In that process that I described as 2 days of work, 1 day off their sentence, I have probably, last year at this time, there was five up here sweeping streets and sidewalks in Bethel. And again, I can't force them. I can say, this is an alternative. And one of the things that a lot of them that qualify want to get out, because I think it was April 1992, I made that building no smoking. And that's pretty tough on prisoners, especially ones that smoke, that to bring them into a facility and say, no more cigarettes, gentlemen or ladies. So a lot of them that qualify for work, public works projects, will go out and do it because they can do it, plus they can have a cigarette. So it kind of is a little incentive there. But it works out fine. I probably have, since 1991, I probably have done about 35 public works projects. And hopefully I'm going to be able to obtain a small bus in 95. And, you take like the town of Peru. The town of Bethel, how I have to set it up is that if a town wants some inmates to come work, they have to come down to the jail, pick them up, bring them to the site, and at least give them a sandwich for lunch or whatever, and bring them back. You take a lot of small towns like, for instance, Peru, Roxbury, they'd like to have the help, but they don't have the personnel to oversee them. They don't have the transportation.
They have to bring them home.
Right. Hopefully they all return. So I want to get, I eventually want to get a small bus so we can, I take a part-time corrections officer and help out these small towns. And, Peru called me last year and said, we'd like three or four to help cut brush along the road. I said, you can have them, but they couldn't set up transportation. And I don't always have the available manpower to do that because of budget constraints. But hopefully in 95, I'm going to be able to get a little extra money to hire a part-time, to take a part-time corrections officer to transport these prisoners around in the jail. Yes, sir.
Years ago, we had I knew of a bootlegger that was 3 months down in jail.
Mm-hmm.
His wife used to come down, and the time he served his sentence, he had it still well back again.
Did he really? Yeah. I would doubt it. My dad is 77 years old. He's 76, born in 1918. And he grew up in the Oxford-Watchville area. And he said when he was a kid, him and his brothers used to once in a while find some of the guys, some of the older men's stills around Oxford-Watchville area. He said, we never got into them. I said, sure. Yes, sir.
What percentage of your prisoners are female?
A very low percentage, actually. But it does fluctuate. Now, for 1993, I carried five females for almost 6 months out of 1993, but predominantly it's the male. It's male inmates. But the female population again is relatively low. It's probably 2-3%, and but it fluctuates, and there's no rhyme or reason there either. We'll all of a sudden we'll get four or five. And then we might have none for 60 days, and then one might come in. I'll tell you what is not a good experience, and I've had two occasions to try to figure this one out. I've had, since 91, I've had 2 9-month pregnant women to serve time. And, my jailer called me up and said, Sheriff, we've got a problem. And I said, okay. And I remember both were pretty much the same. He said, we've got this lady coming in, and she's starting her 9th month of pregnancy, and she's sentenced for 30 days. I said, this is not good. And all I can think of is that we're something's going to happen, and we're going to, first of all, my main concern that something's going to happen. Secondly, my second concern was that she was in my custody under the jail roof, and that if she was going to have that baby, then how the state law works is that hospital bill is ours. It's just the way it works. And I know I didn't plan in my budget for any type of maternity. And so I called Superior Court judges. I knock on wood again. I have a very good rapport with some Superior Court judges. that particular judge, I called him, I said, Judge, you know, this, he said, I feel real bad for you. He said, you know, I had to do it. I had to sentence her for 30 days. It was some serious motor vehicle violation she did. And I said, you know, I don't dispute she committed a crime. She was found guilty. But I said, do you think that we could give her a stay of execution for maybe 6 months? And he said, Sheriff, I don't have any problem with that. He said, just make sure she's got, you know, she's got to serve her time. I said, I will guarantee you I will pick her up personally and bring her back here. So that's what happened. It happened to me twice, and the Superior Court judges were very good because they knew that, you know, I didn't want to have a baby born in the jail, and it wouldn't be born, but we'd have to take the hospital. We'd have to fit the bill. So that's been...
And change the diaphragms.
Yeah. And my corrections officer just haven't had that kind of training. Anything else?
What was the original jail? Was a wooden building somewhere near where the old Paris Hill jail is. Is that correct?
Yes.
You know where that was?
No, I know. Roland DeCoto, the teacher down in that passed away a couple years ago, was my history teacher in junior high. Roland told me some information on that. And he said it was someplace in proximity, but I don't know exactly where, but he said it was a wooden structure.
You know how many prisoners the old Paris Hill jail held?
I don't stand. Sky Lamont, who is the librarian there, we were talking about one day, and he said something about five prisoners. And he said, and I remember him saying, since there's about five rings around here, and that's where they chained them. They literally chained them. So I think it was about five that they could hold in there. But I've got to do some more research on that and try to find out more about the old, which is the library now. Yes?
How much recidivism do you have?
Well, on burglaries, it's kind of funny because on burglaries and property crimes, we have probably, and it's devastating. I mean, I'm not pleased at all. Nobody else should be either. That's why the system, there's something wrong out there. We know that. On property crimes, we have about a 52% recidivism. But I'll tell you what is good news, is that operating under the influence, OUI, in 1991, again, I started what they call the alternative OUI plan. And for every 3 months, I collect people who are first-time offenders for a drunk driving, and I collect them through the court system for 3 months, and then I find a school location, and for a weekend I bring them into the school. They stay there, they sleep there in the gymnasium with our corrections officers guiding them, and they do projects. They paint, they clean buses, they wash windows, whatever. I've been running that, and I've done my ninth program, and my ninth one was at SAD Body 4, and they painted just about the whole interior of the school. That recidivism rate for first-time offenders, after implementing that program, recidivism rates have been about 12% for those first-time offenders to come back in, because what we do, we work them, and we also give them an 8-hour block of education on intoxicating. Alcohol, driving, and stuff like that. And so we've got a good handle on that. But on the property crimes, we still see the same faces back and back again. I don't know what to do. I just don't know. Yes, Rudy.
There was an interesting letter to the editor in the Sun Journal about a week or 10 days ago. A lady whose son was in jail, mm-hmm. and she related her experience of going to visit him. And he was happier than a clam at high tide, laying around doing nothing, eating three squares a day, and watching TV.
Yeah.
And she questioned whether this was helping his problem at all.
Probably not.
I wondered whether you had a comment on that.
Probably not. And I don't know if she was, I think she was writing about Androscoggin.
I think so.
Androscoggin jail, which doesn't make any difference. I've got people in my facility that have done a serious enough crime, the security risk is high enough, so they sit there in jail. They don't go anyplace. Granted, I have to give them 3 square meals a day. I have to give them medical attention when needed. I have to give them dental when needed, because that's the law. But I can tell you that because of budget restraints, lack of personnel, I mean, we're just doing the best that we can with that inmate and giving him in-house some opportunities to perhaps better himself. If he doesn't take those opportunities that we give him through the adult education program, the AA program, some type of a clergy denomination visiting him, if he doesn't take advantage or she doesn't take advantage of that, there's nothing I can do about it. But I can tell you that the mother that wrote that, her feelings and how she feels about that is she's bitter. You know, she's seeing somebody set in jail, and he's kind of happy being there and he's being taken care of. But I can tell you that the majority of inmates that you talk to, jail is not a nice place to be.
Well, that's true.
But you know, I myself and other sheriffs can only do so much to, you know, get these people interested in doing something to better themselves.
Sure.
You know, unfortunately, we have harvested a society, and there's a certain percentage of that society with the language, I don't have to do it if I don't want. And unfortunately, we're dealing with that today. There's no more. There's a certain percentage out there that has no respect for nobody. They don't. You know, we just owe them everything, and they don't owe us anything. So it's very difficult. It's very frustrating. I see a lot of parents and a lot of relatives coming in and visiting the inmates, and I feel really bad for them, because a lot of them are hardworking citizens and try to do the right thing. And it's too bad that a son, a daughter, or a relative ended up committing a crime and in jail. Anyone else?
What would a typical meal be? I'm sure that if I were in jail, I must have had too much bad time.
Yeah.
But I know damn well if I was in there, I'd be thinking both of you going to feed me.
Well, for you, I know that I would have to come up with something. Same table, so I know. What a typical meal would be, and I have to tell you, the meals, this is another jail standard, that each meal that we have a 6-week daily menu that we have to go by, and this menu has to be approved by a state dietitian, and so we have to go by a specific amount of carrots, specific amount of meat, whatever that be. And, you know, there's two sets of standards here on how much an inmate will get. The ones that stay in there that do not do anything get a lesser calorie proportion, less fat proportion than the ones that go out and do something daily. And that only makes sense. But typical morning breakfast, cold cereal, orange juice, toast. Another morning they may have oatmeal. By standards, I only have to feed them one hot meal a day. I can feed them two. Traditionally, what I do is every other day for lunch, they get some kind of a sandwich. Usually we have a tossed salad, and they usually get some type of fruit for dessert. I have a full-time cook. He's quite a character. He's a retired Navy cook, and he doesn't give those inmates any space at all. They eat his food or they go hungry. He comes in his whites, I think the same ones that he wore when he was in the Navy. And as I tell him, he runs a real tight ship up there. But we have a couple part-time cooks that come in, and I get a lot of surplus food from the state of Maine, federal government. And I get a lot of flour, I get a lot of different nuts and raisins, and I've got two part-time cooks that come in to, because the full-time cook heads off the weekend, they come in and they do all kinds of baking. They do cookies, they do pies, they do cakes. And again, we use this free stuff that is donated to us, and processing money, but the inmates love it. And the two women part-time cooks I got, I'm telling you, it's a good thing I'm not up there. They make the best chocolate chip cookies you ever tasted. And but we do a lot of that. So they get fed. They get fed good. They may say, I didn't have enough, but we'll say, this is what we're told to give you, you know. So, you know, Christmas we do, Christmas and Thanksgiving, we do a little extra. We cook a, you know, we cook the turkey up, we cook the ham up, and we, you know, they usually have as much as that as they want, whoever's in there. So, you know, I mean, they're treated pretty good. They're treated pretty good, even with meals. Nobody goes away hungry. You know, it's not like, you know, not the bread and water routine by no means, because they're fed really well. And at nighttime, and I have a lot of pasta donated to us through the food federal government. And you know, I feed them spaghetti. Or some type of pasta a couple times a week. I eat it. What's wrong with me? I mean, I eat it at home. And so, I mean, they are taken care of real well, and they have fresh vegetables and everything. And the food bill there traditionally has been fluctuating because of headcount year to year, but the food bill there will run between $38,000 and $42,000 a year. And this is, you know, this is using all the federal stuff that we can get, and this is, I'm on a food plan where I buy the very cheapest I can from food distributors throughout the state of Maine, and, but it's not, as they say, it's not.